psychologist, world traveler, my old friend and longtime associate, Professor Ludwig von Drey.
Now, everybody knows you have a camera. Now, the picture comes in here and is broken down into three primaries and picked up by election tubes after the primaries.
The Wonderful World of Color premiered Sunday night, September 24th, 1961, along with an eccentric new character, Donald Duck's uncle. Professor Ludwig von Drake was television's leading expert on just about everything.
Anything? What's this? This doesn't even belong here. Besides, what do you want to bother your head about all this technical stuff? It's very simple. All you do is turn this little knob, and you've got your picture. See? That's all. All right, come on. You turned a little knob, and you got the picture. All right, I turned a knob. Didn't I turn the knob? What are you doing with that? I guess it takes some time to warm up. I don't know about this. Oh, this is murder.
Color. I distinctly remember the first time I saw The Wonderful World of Color in something other than black and white. And to watch the opening credits in color, that was a mesmerizing thing, with the flowers blooming and Tinkerbell flying around. And that song, "The World is a Carousel of Color, Wonderful, Wonderful Color."
The world is a carousel of color, history, comedy, fantasy. There's drama and mirth, there's old Mother Earth, with all of her secrets to see. The miracle of imagination, the marvels of earth, sea, and sky. These wonders untold are ours to behold in the funny world, the sunny world, the wonderful world of color.
In your seatbelts, it's going to be a bumpy night. I always love that line. And now, all about Toontown, an animated place where cartoons are king. The word animate means to give life, and over the years, that's exactly what Disney has done. Through four decades of television, Disney cartoon characters have become familiar faces in our living rooms. Everyone knows someone like these guys. Donald Duck was the prototype for going ballistic. Before there was Laid Back, there was Goofy. And as far as good-looking hunks go, there have been two great movie stars with big ears, Clark Gable and Mickey Mouse.
Hey! Hey, you! Are you the first original Mickey Mouse?
Like most American boys and girls, I grew up with Mickey Mouse. The early comic strips and his adventures, which were real cliffhangers, had a big influence on me when I was a kid. I think the thing that set Disney apart in terms of his innovation was, first and foremost, that he gave personalities to the characters. Mickey Mouse was the first cartoon character to have a real personality, and a personality you could identify with.
By 1955, Mickey Mouse was the most durable movie star in history, and his TV fan club made him a folk hero for a new generation of children.
Who's the leader of the club that's made for you and me?
M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Hey there, hi there, ho there, you're as welcome as can be.
M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Forever let us hold our banner high.
High, high, high.
Come along and sing your song and join the jamboree.
M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Walt had always wanted to do a television show for children, and I don't think we all realized the impact that Mickey Mouse was having on the kids of America, and you know, afterwards and looking back, think how lucky we were to be on such a classic American show.
Mouseketeers, roll call, count off now.
Ken, Bobby, M.F., Tommy, Doreen, Bobby. Ken. Ronnie.
Walt Disney was always looking for the kids next door. Wanted the kids at home to be able to associate with us. He didn't want slick professionals who would have staged voices and be phonies. And everybody wanted to be a Mouseketeer. I mean, and it was a great babysitter. I mean, the mothers could put their kids in front of that TV from 5 to 6 every day and make dinner. And at 6 o'clock, dinner's ready. The kids are finished with the Mickey Mouse Club. Everybody was happy. You know, it was just a daily ritual. People didn't want to miss that cereal, and they wanted to see what the Mouseketeers were going to sing and dance that day.
School, the Mickey Mouse Club came on. I remember America's heart throb. My first big love was Annette Funicello. Beautiful little Annette. And the Spinning Marty. Well, I faithfully watched Spinning Marty.
Mickey Mouse Club presents Further Adventures of Spinning Marty. Starring Tim Considine, David Stollery, Annette Funicello.
How old are you, Annette?
16.
Girls get all the breaks.
In what way?
Well, when a girl's 16, she can get married if she wants to. But a guy has to wait until he's 21 or so.
Some boys get married when they're only 19.
Oh, yeah, if they're going into the service or something. But a guy really shouldn't get married until he's got a job. Or at least knows what he's going to do. I mean, what kind of career he's gonna pick, or what kind of business.
That's what I think, Spin.
He should at least be, well, sort of started out in life, so he can support a girl before he gets married.
My folks feel that way, too.
It helps out, I guess. Kind of expensive getting married. Well, shall we get on with the play?
I love the Mickey Mouse Club. But the part I hated most is when I knew the kids were coming out to sing M.I.C.
Now it's time to say goodbye.
I would get sad every time I'd hear it. It hurt every day.
M.I.C.
See you real soon. Why? Because we like you.
Mickey's appeal, Walt Disney once explained, was the triumph of the little guy, a nice fellow who never does anybody any harm. The same could not be said for his best friend. Everything Mickey did right, Donald Duck did wrong. Mickey's success on television was a never-ending torment to this temperamental, foul-tempered fowl.
When you're the sidekick, people think you want to be the number one guy. Well, Donald Duck had the same thing. Everything would be great for Mickey Mouse and not so great for Donald Duck.
Presenting Donald Duck. Here I am, you lucky people. Donald Duck impression. Star on stage, screen, radio, and now, television.
You watched him get flustered and all, moving around. His feet would go a mile a minute and his arms would fluster. He's the last angry man.
Here's my temper.
Donald's legendary temper was a source of inspiration for many of Disney's most memorable television shows, including A Day in the Life of Donald Duck.
I can't understand a word you say.
That's the last one.
Yes, Mr. Duck?
Send my voice in here.
Your voice? Oh, Clarence Nash. Yes, I'll send him right in.
Hi, Donald. Boy, what a beautiful day for the little creatures.
What's good about it?
Why, the birds are singing.
the reason Donald Duck could get away with being such a jerk was because he wore that tight sailor outfit and no pants.
In The Plausible Impossible, Walt himself tested the limits of Donald's temper.
Now you take a real heavy object, say something weighing 3 or 4 tons. This can produce some very plausible effects, both audible and visual. First, the sound, which was made by letting a steel tank drop 10 feet onto the concrete floor of an empty swimming pool, with reverberation added. Now here's an unusual effect. When a character is shot out of a cannon, Donald, the people are waiting.
Goofy was another favorite Disney character. Straight out of vaudeville, his television bits inspired generations of performers.
Goofy, I think, is one of the greatest physical comedians ever lived. I sometimes wish I could do that with my body.
That was so, so funny, especially when they would do it in slow motion. And they would just show his body reacting to some object he's either bouncing off of or heading towards, you know, the facial reactions. Everything, it was just wonderful stuff.
Only the magic of the slow motion camera can do justice to the grace and beauty of this spectacle. As man and beast, responding simultaneously to the gentle undulation, glide through space with a wave-like motion.
I would rank Goofy probably around by a gentle from the likes of De Niro, Pacino, certainly Brando.
There's great soul in Goofy, great soul, great heart. That to me is the vitality of the character.
He's worth $1 million.
He's worth $2 million.
$2,500,000.
$3 million.
$4 million.
$750,000.
What do you mean? $5 million.
Six.
Seven.
Eight. Nine.
$50 a week for 48 years.
You're all breaking.
I think Goofy's probably the perfect physical comic. He's what every human comic hopes he could be. You know, he can tie himself into a pretzel. He can fall out of a 15-story building and bounce.
Okay, Dad. Oh,
just be still, I'm out of here.
I think the animated characters really live inside of us because they are our thoughts and our hopes. And we see them on television slamming against the wall, bang, and they wake up. You know, they never die. They never get old, and they live forever.
Spin it! Let's begin it.
As Disney's animated family continues to grow, its characters have entered a new era of television history, embracing the magic of the past.
Spin it again.
Spin it, let's begin it, bear and grin it. When you're in it, you can win it in a minute. When you spin it, spin it, spin it.
The newest character here in Mickey's Toontown is a bunny with big problems. He was supposed to give me a lift to Frontierland. Here he comes now. Anyway, Roger Rabbit made his first television appearance on Mickey's 60th birthday broadcast. Roger, hold it. Well, right. And he's been messing things up ever since. Roger, excuse me!
Cue the fanfare. Cue Mickey.
Cue Mickey.
I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight. And to all of you out there at home, gosh, thanks for watching the show. It's great to be here.
It's dynamite! I made ya! I'm
Roger Rabbit!
I quit.
When I was a little girl, I didn't play house. I built forts. So with a few cardboard boxes and a little imagination, Custer made his last stand in my backyard. And the Alamo didn't fall till dinner time. To Disney, imagination was the most important frontier. Drawn to the pioneer spirit and searching for new TV characters, the Disney Studios turned its attention to the stories and legends that sprang from American soil.
Born on a mountaintop in Tennessee, green estate in the land of the free, raised in the woods so he knew every tree, killed him a bear when he was only three. Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
Davy Crockett was TV's first miniseries, and it made a star out of an unknown actor named Bess Parker. At first, he didn't want to play the role. He didn't like wearing leather breeches, and he was allergic to horses. Nevertheless, Bess Parker's Davy Crockett came to personify traditions that Americans continue to cherish.
I personally love Davy Crockett. He was the Indiana Jones of that time. He had his gang, he had his pack, and they would get the job done. He was our great American hero, and he had a great sense of humor. That was important, to grin your way out of trouble.
You want to see me, General?
That's right. Come inside. Now, how'd you kill that brute?
With my knife? I was figuring on grinning him to death, but this here stumble-footed major has come along and busted up my concentrate.
Grinning him to death? What in thunderation is that?
Oh, it's something I've been experimenting with. You see, there's nothing so absolutely unresistible as an old-fashioned, good-natured grin. Like this.
God. That was, I kind of dreaded that scene.
Ah!
Well, I worked on a bar.
I spend 5 to 10 hours a weekend meeting people, and they come up and they say, in effect, my life values were shaped by that show.
Why you no kill me?
Maybe because of another law. We have trouble living up to it. Thou shalt not kill.
I think that there's an underlying core to the American personality. This core of values, which really came out of hard work, family cooperation. Walt Disney brought all of that to the screen.
I know who you are. Since when is Davy Crockett a friend of Injuns?
Hollis has been a friend of the Cherokees. Got no bones to pick with the others since we signed the peace with them.
Take a powerful lot of argument to convince me of that.
That's what I come for.
There was no way Davy could be beaten, where if he was challenged, they would leg wrestle. But of course, Davy was able to wrap his leg, catch the other fella, and just pull him right over. Hey, Davy, you know?
You know, he'd come through again.
What made Davy Crockett so appealing was strength. Born on a mountaintop of Tennessee, was able to strike out and wrestle bears when he was a kid. And then he had a certain hat to go along with it. That it wasn't a cowboy hat, it wasn't anyone's hat but Davy Crockett. We all wanted that hat.
Thanks to the enormous popularity of the television series, Davy Crockett's coonskin cap quickly became a national craze. Life magazine said, "It has come down to a question of who will be exhausted first. Raccoons, or the parents who have to buy the caps."
I went to 13 foreign countries with the movie, And it was the same in Sweden as it was in Great Britain or in France. I mean, the coonskin cap and the little toy rifle were the most desired items that many children in the world ever wanted.
Disney's great contribution to folk and fairy tales was to give them an American flavor. Once Upon a Time and Happily Ever After became stories about rags to riches, staking your claim, passing the torch. These were the themes that Walt explored again and again as he spun his yarns, using television as his campfire.
Long time ago, there was a masked rider who rode the countryside. This was in old Spanish California, back in the days of high adventure and low, soft guitar.
When the full moon is bright, comes a horse not known as Zorro. This bold renegade carves a Z with his blade.
It was a pretty positive role model, because you could carve a Z in your underwear. I mean, you know, if you can do that, like, who's not going to like you? Nobody could tell who he was because he had this mask. It was kind of like Superman with his glasses, you know. It's dressed in black. There's something about the guy that dresses in black when you're a kid.
You must show me that again, Comandante. Now, would you please get inside the cell?
The great thing about Zorro, he was a essentially Spanish-Mexican guy putting the white guys in jail, which I kind of dug myself.
Next week, watch Monasterio bait the trap for his mortal enemy. Zorro is wanted, dead or alive. Watch Zorro spring the trap as he matches cold steel with the cruel tyrant. With Zorro, champion of the oppressed and defender of justice, next week when the Walt Disney Studio brings you another thrilling adventure of Zorro.
Boy, oh boy, was Zorro a real person?
I'm afraid not, Moochie. You see, Zorro's a mythical character. He's something of our imagination. What's that?
That's your imagination.
Señores y señoritas.
Zorro.
Disney's love of the American frontier soon inspired a series of tall tale television cartoons.
Howdy, neighbors. I suppose y'all is wondering how come me and my partner Hyman here is all gussied up in this here western-type duds. And how come all this cow pokey talk? Gesundheit. Well, it's simple. We are talking cowboy talk because the next tale I'm gonna tell is an old pioneer type story. It's a real tall western type tall tale type about an hombre named Pecos Bill.
Pecos Bill was quite a cowboy down in Texas, and a western Superman, to say the least.
He was the roughest, toughest critter, never known to be a quitter, cause he never had no fear of man or beast. So yippee-yi-yay, yippee-yi-yo, for the toughest critter west of the Alamo.
Once he wrote the raging cyclone out of nowhere, then he straddled it and settled down with ease. And while that cyclone bucked and flitted, Pecos rolled the smoke and lit it. And he tamed that ornery wind down to a breeze.
So yippee-yi-yo, yippee-yi-yo.
Pecos Bill is a hero man in the Wild West, and he had a great sense of humor.
I think that's part of the American spirit. It's the American grin. It's that Robert Redford, you know, it's times are tough, but don't forget your sense of humor. You know, keep that going along with what you're doing, and I'm sure you'll get through it in some way.
Short Gunderson's my name. I'm river foreman of a timber camp near the Oregon Trail. My outfit was mighty discouraged the day Paul Bunyan arrived. We were getting plenty of timber in the river, but we couldn't move it to the sawmills because the river was so dead burn crooked. Paul looked the situation over careful-like. Then he harnessed Babe with a yoke, hitched on a big anchor, and threw it in at the head of the river.
Yep, Babe!
Well, Paul and Babe, they heaved and hauled, and the job was quickly done. They pulled that crooked river out as straight as a barrel of a gun.
In the wonderful world of Disney, heroes weren't always big, handsome lumberjacks or cowboys who loved to yodel. Sometimes they were right in our own backyards. Sometimes they were even girls.
Pollyanna was a girl who brought happiness to an unhappy town, armed with a single weapon, her optimism.
Hello? Come here. Come right over here.
You have a stubby little nose. What do you think about that?
I know it. I wish I were pretty like you.
Oh, don't you try to.
I think Polly is the kind of character that underlies so many of the Disney movies. How a child's innocence and honesty and love can change a whole community of people.
The original Pollyanna was an enormous success.
Oh, Angelica, call the doctor quickly.
It's just something about that story that rings true, that actually strikes to the very heart of us all.
Hi, honey. You're going to be fine, don't you worry. Goodbye, darling. We're going to visit you in the hospital.
Hey, Snooky, take a look at this, will you?
Really? You mean really? You did it. Oh, Nancy, it's gorgeous,
isn't it? And we're going to wait for you. You're going to be my flower girl.
She's a marvelous character, and we know that this is how we ought to be, without allowing ourselves to get sort of squashed by the problems and the disappointments and the setbacks in life.
In 1989, Debbie Allen directed a new version of this classic tale for Disney's television audience. Pollyanna became Polly. Here, this story's timeless message finds new residents as Polly unites a segregated southern town.
A lot of people here today have worked very hard to make our first annual bazaar a success. And now they're all pretty tired, every one of them. So, we have declared a Polly Day, amen.
Amen.
So that we may get some rest and so that we will not forget that we all need each other here in this town, amen.
I think films make a big difference in our lives because they're so powerful, the images are so vivid and so real. And if we can project that kind of power in a certain direction, we really can alter consciousness. Like the movie with Alfred Woodard, with that scene with the boys and not being able to break the matches when they're all together. You know, divided, we are conquered. Together, we cannot fail. We cannot be separated.
Break it in two.
A Mother's Courage is the true story of basketball star Isaiah Thomas and his mother's struggle to raise her family as a family.
It's easy to break one, but you can't do it with 10. These sticks are like a family. Together, we're strong. We can help each other. But alone, we're just alone and a little weak.
Don't ever forget that.
All of these heroes and heroines that Disney sort of documented over the years, they all kind of come out of the same idea that all these people were pioneers. They all had so much moral integrity. It's such an interesting thing that they're all from different backgrounds, yet they still had the same kind of themes running through, the same values, and they were all just kind of teaching them in different ways.
The word is acronym.
Acronym. A-C-R-O-N-Y-M. Acronym.
In the true story of Cambodian refugee Lin Yan, Disney Television embraced America's most cherished value, freedom.
When Lin Yan arrived from Cambodia, she spoke no English at all. That was 1979.
Acronym. Now, 4 years That's later, the word 12-year-old Lin Yan spelled to win the Hamilton County Zone 5 spelling bee last night. Now, what makes this so?
I'm glad to be in America. I was a slave. Now I can do anything I want to do. I am proud of the people who love me and my family. I am free.
Disney once declared, Disneyland will never be completed as long as there is imagination in the world. Welcome to the Indiana Jones adventure, and behold the Temple of the Forbidden Eye. According to ancient superstition, one look at the god within means certain doom. It was discovered in 1935 by daredevil archaeologist Indiana Jones, and will soon be rediscovered by the public. Walt's original inspiration for Disneyland came from his experience as a father. Back in the 1940s, he took his daughters to amusement parks. Critical of the cheap rides, the smell of beer and hot dogs, he wondered, why isn't there a pleasant place for families to spend time together? A vision grew in his mind, a vision he shared each week on TV's most popular new series.
On our first television program, we showed you a blueprint for a dream. Well, this is the blueprint, and the dream is Disneyland, the park that we're constructing near Anaheim, California. We promised to keep you informed as our dream became a reality. So, for a first-hand progress report, let's visit Disneyland now.
What the hurry, what the worry, why the bustle and the hustle, why the concentration and sudden inspiration?
It's because the date's been planned to open Disneyland.
The frontier gate is set up and there can't be any let-up. We must do our best to finish all together. Hurry, 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 there's no time to sit and worry. Check the castle, fill the lake, or see for goodness sake.
Make a rocket, that's exciting,
a boat trip, that's inviting.
The time is ticking fast, and we've got to finish fast, but we'll be there when they open Disneyland.
On July 17th, 1955, Walt Disney cast open the gates of Disneyland. Millions watched as the festivities were broadcast live on a coast-to-coast telecast.
How do you do, everyone? This is Hank Weaver. For the past year, this signature has announced the opening of Disneyland, the show. Now, it announces the opening of Disneyland, the place. The world's most fabulous kingdom will be unveiled before an invitational world premiere, and you are guests. Art Linkletter will be your host, and with ABC crews and cameras on the spot, we'll guide you through this truly magic land.
Walt Disney asked me if I would ask a couple of my friends who were quick-witted and good with words to come and join Walt and me as the hosts. So I asked Bob Cummings, the wonderful comic actor, and Ronnie Reagan, who was my neighbor down at Holmby Hills. And so the four of us set out with no rehearsal and a few notes and dived into a coast-to-coast show together.
Well, this job in the next hour and a half is going to be a delight. I feel like Santa Claus with a $17 million bundle of gift packages all wrapped in whimsy
and sent your way over television with the help of 29 cameras.
Despite the best laid plans of mice and men, almost nothing went smoothly on opening day.
Now, of course,
Disneyland opening was finally called Black Sunday because the crowds were bigger than they ever expected. The heat was higher than we'd ever anticipated. The overloads on electricity, which blew up rides and stopped lighting. You could hardly get anybody to pay attention to you.
A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal.
One time I had to rush to over by the Toad ride, and there was a pile of lumber nearby, and they'd put the microphone under it so nobody would see it and steal it. And of course, I couldn't find it either. And I knew from the script that Bob Cummings was going to send it to me inside of 20 seconds.
Oh, you're waiting for me? Oh, thank you. Everybody is waving at Bob Cummings over here, so I guess I'm back on. And oh, and I see Art Linkletter right now. Art Linkletter is looking for a microphone. He looks all confused. He's standing over there in front of the Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. And I think if...
yes, there were many little things like that. Walt was very proud and very nervous for the first time.
Dedication for the happiest kingdom of them all, Fantasyland. Here is a world of imagination, hopes, and dreams. In this timeless land of enchantment, the age of chivalry, magic, and make-believe are reborn, and fairy tales come true. Fantasyland is dedicated to the young and the young in heart, to those who believe that when you wish upon a star, your dreams do come true.
Open the Fantasyland Castle!
Kind of haunted for all of us who were there that first day. It's very gratifying to see the park got bigger. We moved the railroad track I don't know how many times. I don't think it would have surprised Walt at all.
To a kid growing up in the 1950s, Disneyland was Oz and Walt the Wizard. Each and every Sunday night, the wonderful world of Disney gave us a peek behind his magic curtain.
The best episodes of that show always began with Walt standing around in his office.
This is what we call our Imagineering department. It's where we dream up our new projects.
And there were some of those shows in which Walt would just be in his office, and it seemed like he'd talk for 45 minutes, and then they show some clips of technicians working on robots or something like that. Those were always the best. Those are the most fascinating.
The building of Disneyland gave us a new art and a new type of artist, one that works with a slide rule and a blowtorch instead of pencil and brush.
It was literally this very, very pleasant man sitting there and telling us about these wonderful things that were coming our way.
This is the carousel theater host. Whatever the man in the harness does, this figure will respond simultaneously in the same manner. But you care for your life. I don't think we better. No smoking on the stage.
He was a kind of a technology freak in a lot of ways. And then, of course, when he was building Disneyland, he also wanted people to, first of all, see how it was being built, and second, see, for instance, how the audio animatronic figures work.
Audio animatronics?
Right, audio animatronics. Audio for sound.
See, and electronically animated by sound. That's what he's trying to say.
Thank you, that was all I was trying to say.
Excuse me, Walt.
Well, the word animatronics today is accepted as a form of creating any robotics for film. We use it freely. Animatronics. The fact of the matter is that the word animatronics comes from Disney.
What you are seeing is a man operating a machine that activates the mechanical features of this head.
As a matter of fact, every movement and sound of all the tenants of the Haunted Mansion is directed in this manner.
Send us a message from somewhere beyond.
Everything I think that Disney stood for and everything he brought to us was so universal in how it touched you. Disney put a smile on our faces. He let us kids think like kids, and as we grew up, we continued to think those thoughts.
As the moon climbs high over the dead oak tree, Creepy creeps with eerie eyes. Grim grinning ghosts come out to socialize.